Yes, okay.
I'm just kidding. True.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. We're here today to present to you Arguing the Future with my team members.
Ready, Ganoon.
Caleb.
Danny.
And I'm Hadel Hindu. And we begin.
So invention, writing about the future. So we need to see a deep connection with the past, present, and future. So when you argue about the future, you need to have the past and present in your mind, because the future emerges from it.
The future is purely hypothetical, but a good argument can convince you of a different type of version of future. Convincing arguments usually contain patterns of behaviors. However, it is possible that future can diverge from the past. A good writer will make a future that's plausible. In the example shown, the 41% over the years is a pattern that will help provide evidence for the argument.
Starting places. The goal is to get the reader to believe that one particular future with a diverse realm of scenarios is likely or possible. So you have to convince the reader that the present situation will likely happen in the future.
Alright, so analyzing the future or the situation. One must understand the functions of the present and the past to be able to understand the future and its functions. So questions will be applied, like what factors influence or the political, social, cultural, global, and environmental factors that will be influenced in the future as well. Next, we have entering argument. There are many methods to secondary research and conducting research, and one is secondary research, which is a common research method used by combining primary sources into one, which makes it secondary. Here we have inventing thesis, and the main objective is to find new ways to argue the future by looking at the past and its potential. So you argue for the hopes and the fears of what may occur. Questions will be applied here as well, like the possible specific outcomes and the proponents to it. And the most engaging arguments are the ones that don't end up where they began. There was also an example in the passage that Nelson used, which argued that college tuition will be too high for most people in the future, which is considered on the safe side because he has no proof of the past and the present to be able to predict what is going to be in the future.
So after you invent the thesis, you obviously need to invent support to support your thesis. So as you know, thesis is your main topic sentence of your argument, so it's important to support it. And creating support usually has any logical connections between what has happened, what tends to happen, and what the writer will think will happen and needs to convince the reader will happen. Common types of support is allusions, facts, statistics, and appeals to logic. Now, allusions really ground your argument. Because the future is very hypothetical, you need to ground it in the past, which gives the reader a better way to connect to it. Next is facts, which just make it stronger. And statistics also create a compelling argument, but the thing is, you need to have an argumentative strategy around it and have context, because having random percentage and like numbers will not make a plausible point for the reader to understand. And finally, you have appeals to logic, which just convince the reader that the premise is acceptable and that the writer's version of the future is what will probably happen. So in this example, Nelson actually uses many persons to like as statistics, and he has an argumentative strategy as well as context, because he has authority at the College Board, and you know the context, which is the annual survey of colleges, as well as the year it was taken in. And this passage helps continue the argument. Later on, he uses this past statistics to help make a compelling argument about the future and how the tuition will increase in the future.
Authors in the argument means find a common ground to connect to his fingers to strike interest. those words we ourselves can reach towards the audience, create common ground to strike interest. Any opinion shown is a widely known opinion, so it allows an author to build upon his argument because he can connect to his readers.
And finally, there's the audience's voice. Again, because the argument is about the future, it's hypothetical. And that means that the writer has an increased need to connect to the reader using the voice, and as well as strategies like questions. Now, questions, there's different questions like rhetorical questions, which are basically statements, but give a different format. So the format of the argument isn't repetitive. And then questions without answers, which even though the author doesn't have an answer, they explore a point that they think the reader needs to know about. And then finally there's questions with answers, which really just slows down the argument so the reader can follow along and isn't overwhelmed with information. And then because it's hypothetical, there needs to be intensity. The reader must be able to imagine the particular version of the future that the writer is arguing about. So the intensity helped the reader do that. But along with the intensity, the reader must trust the author that they're being credible. So a credible sounding voice is very important, just so the argument seems very plausible. Now, for example, in this, the first is a question with an answer, and it's talking about, doesn't the college tuition increase at roughly the rate of inflation? And the author denies this. And this opinion is actually a misconception that many readers could possibly have, that inflation is equal with the rise of tuition, but it's not, and the writer is putting emphasis on that by using this format. And then the next passage has urgency with phrases like unless something gives, and talking about $200,000 to $300,000, which is a vast amount of money for college. And that gives it a sense of intensity, but he keeps the credible sounding voice because later on in the last part, he leaves it up to the reader to imagine the ill effects. So if he had made up specific predictions, the reader might not have agreed with those, but by leaving it up to the reader, he makes it more credible and plausible.
Finally, revisions. At this point, the writer needs to make sure that his argument is more intense and engaging. So in order to do that, he needs to revise the whole essay and delete anything that's vague or any wordy sentences or cliches.
In conclusion, the argument of the future entails using the past and present to persuade the reader of your vision of the future. Thank you for your time. Any questions?
I need 3 claps.
Thank you. That was nice. I'm glad I've been here with y'all, because I'm glad the other classes.